international cooperation as we build trust within a global community. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You can hear now from Wendy Watson, MP, the Parliamentary Under Secretary of State, the Foreign, Commonwealth and Development Office.
Thank you. ladies and gentlemen, dear veterans, dear friends and guests, and the honored today to take part in this wonderful ceremony devoted to the 80th anniversary of departure of Arctic convoys that arrived 2 weeks later to the city of Archangel. It happened during the initial period of war, which was the most difficult time in the history of the Soviet Union. The courage and valor of our people joining forces in the fight against a vicious enemy of all humanity, and many sacrifices and heroic deeds which are forever engraved in our collective memory. Today we are not only honoring the shared history and joint achievements of our countries in the World War II, but also the true brotherhood, the arms of our people, a fine example of which we are the Arctic. The service, bravery, and determination of the Allied seamen allowed them to withstand the attacks of enemy forces under the ice breeze of the Arctic, to deliver the life-saving supplies to the Soviet Union for the fight against the Nazi Germany on the Eastern Front. Over almost 4 years, 40 convoys of some 800 vessels from Britain and other allies countries transported millions of tons of supplies, tanks, aircrafts, ammunition, communication equipment, raw materials, medical supplies, and hospital equipment. The Arctic convoys alone made up to just over 20% of total equipment delivered to the USSR from the Allies. It was the shortest but most dangerous way of delivery. But these supplies were most welcome in the Soviet Union and were received with deep gratitude, as real support from the Allies in expectation, of course, of the opening of the Western Front. Not to mention the importance of delivery of provisions supplies to the besieged Leningrad at that time. The Arctic convoy operations faced many threats from the enemy in the air as well as on and below the treacherous waters, inevitably taking close to German bases, Norway, from which Nazi submarines, aircrafts and ships could easily reach them. And my colleague has already mentioned the words of Winston Churchill, that I also have to repeat, the worst journey in the world, it is pretty often said about these problems. In winter, among many challenges were the bitter cold, pitch darkness and thick fog, as well as strong currents, all making the already difficult route even more unbearable. These factors made the chances of surviving and completing the dangerous journey ever more slim. Many thought it was not feasible for the ships to get through, but professionalism, boldness and courage of the seamen made it possible despite all the odds. You, dear veterans, won the fight against the illness and enemy to deliver the much needed help assistance. We sincerely admire and respect. Thank you very much for that. In honor of this heroic fact, feat upon the decree of the President of the Russian Federation, the embassy has been presenting the Russian State Award, the Medal of Admiral Ushakov, to Arctic convoy veterans. And since 2014, almost 3,500 medals have been found by the heroes, and we are determined to pursue this initiative once the pandemic becomes a thing of the past. This year, I also had the privilege of participating in the pre-slaying ceremony at the Arctic convoy memorial on the shore of Loch Hewn in northwest Scotland. And another commemorative event is also going to take place at the end of August in a gauntlet at Cato, where Federal University will organize an international conference due to this event. The memory of these and other heroic examples of joint combat and mutual support will forever live in our hearts. And in this context, I would like to mention the outstanding efforts of the group of enthusiasts established the Russian Arctic convoy museum in Scottish Loch Hewn, which houses various artifacts and memorabilia commemorating this historic event right where they happen. With the ongoing renovation and planned expansion of the exhibition space, the embassy intends to provide support in enlarging of the exposition, and we are hopeful that this will become a joint effort working towards with the help of British authorities as well. I would also like to thank the British Embassy in Moscow for traditionally supporting these kind of efforts to preserve our public orders for historic leadership. And I sincerely believe that we should and will serve as a fine example of an amity between our nations for generations to come. In the face of various global challenges and threats, the world needs such friendship, mutual respect, and cooperation more than ever. Once again, I would like to congratulate the dear veterans and wish them and the family good health, joy and peace. Thank you very much.
And in those days, you could not just go ashore, but what I learned on the cultural tour in Murmansk about the convoys and the deprivations of war at sea have stayed with me through this day. And now, many years later, as I sit in my office at Trinity House in London, I look out at the National Memorial to the merchant navy seafarers who perished at sea. And on that memorial are the names of 8,094 ships and 36,087 seafarers whose only grave is the sea, some of whom perished on the Arctic convoys. Part of the wording on the memorial reads, "It is upon them, under the good providence of God, that our wealth, safety, and very existence almost wholly depend." And I'd now like to read you a short poem written by a merchant seaman in 1943. "Reserve, I pray, one lusty cheer for the men whose names you never hear, who win no stripes and wear no braid, but face great dangers unafraid, who go wherever ships are sent, whose breasts no medals borne anent, whose deeds no scrolls of honour stress, but who are heroes nonetheless, who sail the ocean's vast expanse, nor hesitate to take their chance against the swift torpedo's blast, nor know which trip will be their last, who take both peace and war in stride, who when torpedoes strike go over sound, perchance to be the lucky man who lives to sail the seas again. I give you then each gallant crew of liner, freighter and tanker too, outbound I know not where or when, the men who man our merchant fleet, whose bones lie in the ocean deep, unknown, unheard of, and unsung. God keep you now, and your task is done."
Century, unlike the majority of other wars before, all combatants
seafarers knew why they were there and what they were fighting for. More than that, they all believed in the cause for which they were fighting. And so the determination with which they made these journeys, even though from the beginning it became clear that the dangers they faced were not just from the enemy, was one of belief and conviction. The Arctic convoys were also a testament to collaboration and trust, not just between nations, but also between the armed forces and the merchant navy, and between government in London and those who were planning and actually delivering the first stage of the journey here in Liverpool. These themes of compassion, sacrifice, courage, determination, collaboration and trust are all ideas we can associate with the convoys, but they're often applied in retrospect. The reality of war is captured in the accounts of those who were there. These accounts take you away from the high-minded themes and into the delicate truth of conflict. We've already heard one contemporary poem read by Captain McNaught. Other accounts include lines such as, "The worst thing about these convoys was the weather. You could hit a storm that would last about 3 days. The seas were unbelievable. You could look up and see water stretching above you as high as a block of flax." Another seafarer wrote, "I realised life in the Navy was concerned with fighting the sea every bit as much as fighting the enemy." But of course the enemy also presented danger. Writing of the loss of his ship, one man wrote, "Only a handful of men were picked up from the quickly frozen sea. Almost 2,000 went down. But in the spirit of him or me, we were jubilant, unmoved by the scale of such a loss of life." Well, these accounts were written many years later, but they still capture the immediacy of people who were not looking at the bigger picture, but were focused on a task. One of the compelling aspects of our reading from the Bible this morning is the immediacy of the narrative. The feeding of the 5,000 was a well-known story. We didn't need to hear it this morning to know the basic thrust of the narrative. And the passage that we heard included some of those themes of compassion and collaboration. But giving food to the people in that place is not as striking as the decision to act for the good when it was required. Jesus said to his disciples, and I slightly paraphrase, "They need not go away, you do something." Responding to a situation is the most significant act we do. Our responsibility towards each other is always to do something, to respond, even if the response itself brings a greater challenge. As the first convoy ships left Liverpool 8 years ago, as I said at the beginning, they would have seen the tower of this church as they turned to look at the shore, just as thousands of others had in the centuries before. For hundreds of years, and in fact still today, seafarers used to call in here before departing on voyages. But apart from this tower, as I across the tower behind me, as I said, this building itself lay in ruins by August 1941. But the seafarers, when it was built, continued to come here, and they still do. They pray here for a safe voyage. It's clear from the first-hand accounts that most of those in the convoy were not particularly focusing on those themes of compassion, sacrifice, courage, determination, collaboration and trust, but surrounded by absolute friends, they were responding to the needs of an embattled ally to the east, to the strategic imperative of managing a second front, and most memorable, they were responding daily to the challenges, the conditions which are barely imaginable as we sit here today. As we commemorate these events, praying for those who died and giving thanks for those who returned,
pray as well for ourselves, that we respond when we are called. And that famous quotation of Churchill, already been mentioned a couple of times this morning, and he finished with another bit of Churchill. He said, "I never worry about action, but only inaction."
Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
the life blood of people and nations right around the world is trade. We all need food or materials and goods to survive and thrive. And so the historical and the future presence of every nation has been and remains to protect that trade in times of peace and war, protect it against the ravages of the sea and of our enemies. So when Germany invaded Soviet Union in the largest operation the world could ever see, the most immediate support America, Canada, and Great Britain could provide to their Russian allies was to send ships and sailors across the Arctic Sea, laden with supplies. And as we've heard, the route to Murmansk was the shortest, but also the most dangerous, as the Kriegsmarine and Luftwaffe grasped quickly the strategic importance of the crucial operation and strained every sinew to start it, attacking with aircraft, ships, and submarines. And so began one of the most politically vital struggles of the Second World War. But what did that mean? What did that mean for the men and women of the Royal Navy? And those of our brothers and sisters from the Canadian and American navies? Well, I can do no better than to bring it to life through the words of those who endured it. And for them, the first foe to be conquered was, of course, the sea itself. George Dunmore, HMS Milne, wrote in a letter home, "On our first convoy, we received a ration of potatoes. They were frozen solid, having been stored in a bench locker on the upper deck. On thawing them out, they were just like sponges. We squeezed the water out and finished up with just a handful of withered skins. Not terribly edible. But we do have plenty of meat. One of the highlights are pork chops from America. They're huge, fully an inch thick. And when the weather's bad, we just have to fall back on doorstep sandwiches of Spam and Bulgogi." But this was an ocean journey like no other, for conquering the Arctic Sea was a daily battle in its own way. Bill Smith from HMS Magpie wrote in his journal, "The sea is a violent wave, violent thing, waves of 30 foot plus. But we met again in the Atlantic, we went into it barrel off, plowed through. But in the Arctic, east of Bear Island, the sea comes from the beak. This means we're rolling as much as 30 degrees to port and starboard, with the deck covered in ice and snow. We have to use lifelines when going aft to the guns and the mortars. But when she rolled, we feel the deck moving 30 degrees, and you're left physically hanging out over the sea, dangling above the icy waters. At maximum roll, the ship would shudder for a few seconds, and then decide whether or not to come back or to turn over. You never quite sure which. The temperature was as low as 60 degrees below freezing. Your eyebrows and eyelashes froze, and your eyes were sore and streaming from the roof. Men came off the watch with faces covered in blood as they rubbed their faces and noses without realizing. And so on top of that, on top of the ravages of the sea, of course there was the violence of the enemy, the ever-present threat. Sailor First Class Terence Donovan, the cruiser HMS London, wrote after the war, "I still think of those trips to and from Russian ports, of those nail-biting, apprehensive terms of duty in the border of engine rooms, with only a couple of inches of steel separating us from the icy Arctic, and with packs of U-boats intent on making a big gap in those couple of inches of steel." Don McKinnon, one of just 61 survivors when HMS Liverpool was torpedoed in 45, described what happened when those submarines went through. The U-boat hit us on the starboard side of the engine. We went down in 7 minutes. The ship was broken in two. The funnel was knocked out and the masts were broken. We knew she was sinking. We had to wait for the order. The captain had been knocked unconscious by the explosion. First lieutenant was killed. And so it was for the second lieutenant who had to give the order. Abandon ship. Every man for himself. So we just had to jump over. When I landed in that freezing cold water, I thought of God. I never thought I was dead. I managed to swim and I saw a big rock with 15 sailors on. They were shouting, come on, keep going. He could see bodies everywhere. Those who had died of cold, some who had been killed by the explosion. When HMS Savage picked up that raft 2 hours later, there were only six of us alive. We were unconscious, so when they took us on board, they didn't know which of us were living or dead. They put us in the shower twice to warm us through and take all the dirt and grease off us. That's when I regained consciousness, in the shower. A leading senior came over and said, do you know where you are? And I said, sorry, shit, I haven't got a way there before. I thought these first-hand accounts so vivid, so poignant. Images and senses I remember well when I was still a young boy reading my grandfather's letters home. He joined HMS Victoria, a Royal Navy escort carrier here in Liverpool in Britain, and served in the Arctic convoys in 1944. While we both shared a career in engineering, I never had the privilege of meeting him, as he was lost in the Penelope and Chief's torpedo in the Mediterranean. And so what a very particular honour it is for me to meet Dennis and Alex today, and to be here to salute them and their ship. Those with us and those now past. And to thank those representatives of our navies here today and the great maritime city of Liverpool, who continue to fan the flames of our collective memories of the incredible service and sacrifice of the men and women involved in this Herculean effort to support our allies in Russia. From the men and women of today's war,